Welcome, everybody. This is your boy, Megalodon J. I have a special guest today, Miss Kendall Ellis, USC alum. Fight on. Whoa, whoa. How you doing today?
I'm doing well. How about you?
Doing pretty good. You know, besides the pandemic, I mean, I'm surviving. How are you? Where's your mask?
We're on deck, in the house, in the car. Got multiple. Good to go.
That's a good deal. Good deal. Stay safe out there. Kids, I hope you're seeing this. Stay safe. Miss Ellis is staying safe. So I have to ask you, I'm going to come right out the gate to ask you, because I did not know that you were from St. Thomas Aquinas.
Absolutely. Best high school in the world.
I agree with you. Because when I seen that, I said, oh, man, I did not know. So I have to ask you, what are y'all drinking out there at St. Thomas Aquinas? Because it seems like everybody that touches the soil out there is just like blessed with wealth out there. Like, I don't understand.
It's that Florida limestone water, all the minerals and all that. It's from the faucet water.
Faucet water.
Yeah.
You know, that's almost like the time when Usain Bolt said Jamaican yams.
Tap water, faucet water, whatever. That's what it is. It's the minerals.
It's the minerals. Man, that's awesome, man. Because I was going, I'm doing some research, and I was like, you know what? And then I seen this ridiculous number, 7-time.
Oh, yeah. It's been a while. It's been some years.
Man, so how does that feel like, you know, because I know you go home from time to time. Mm-hmm. How does it feel to go home and realize that you have basically conquered that landscape out there? And you know, because I know you're a legend up there at St. Thomas Aquinas, I'm sure.
Right. It feels good, though. It always feels good. I don't get to go home that often. But when I do, it's like, you know, home is really where the heart is. And it's like, it's just so nice to feel appreciated. And I go back to my high school, and I'm still very, very close to my high school coach. So I always link up with the team when I'm in town and meet with the athletic director and just look back at like all the trophies and they picture up now. So I'm like, yes, like I'm really here. Like I left my mark.
That's awesome, man. That's awesome. So I do have another question for you, because I'm a big fan of USC. Mm-hmm. I love that program out there. That coach out there is amazing.
Right.
Amazing in every way. Like, it seems like when an athlete comes to that USC program, it's like, and then they just blossom to something beautiful in track and field. And I love that program out there. So I have to ask you, with you being a Floridian, mm-hmm. That's how you pronounce it, right? Floridian? But you being a Floridian, what made you choose USC over the Florida Gators? Because that program is nice too.
Well, first of all, no shade, but UF didn't recruit me like that. I'm not even gonna lie. Like, they didn't recruit, but no, it wasn't intentional. It was like, I remember like the coach talking to my coach, and he was like, she's going all the way to California, like what? And he's like, well, did you recruit her? And he was like, well, no, but I just like, I think it was kind of an assumption that like, because I was a Floridian, I would want to stay in state, but like everyone who knew me knew I was never gonna do that. So It was just like a slip up on his end, and I have nothing but love for him. It was just like a funny conversation after the fact that like, yeah, you got to recruit me just as hard as you and be like out of state kid. Like, it's no guarantee just cause I'm from Florida. But yeah, I never wanted to stay in state. I feel like, you know, spent 18 years in Florida. Why not go somewhere else for 4 years? Like, it's school, try something new. Coach Carol and I had met prior when she was coaching at UCF, and I really liked her. And I was like, man, I would love to be coached by her. Too bad she's in Florida. Like, it's a wrap if she's in Florida. Always had a thing for California, just a weird, like, I want to go to California. Like, I think it's going to be great out there. And when I heard she was switching to USC, I was like, all right, it's a done deal. Coach I want in the state that I want. Easy selling point.
Great marriage, right? Great marriage. I mean, it worked out for you. You know what? Hey, New Balance.
Yeah.
New Balance. Yeah. So I have another question for you, because like a lot of times we see athletes make this transition, and I am also a former runner, and I was training out in Claremont at that facility out there for a year before I messed up my Achilles. And I definitely know the transition from college to pro is different. Cause I'm gonna tell you the truth. Like, I went from running pretty fast to racing against guys who weren't like Tyson Gay, and I was still getting the brakes blown off of me, and I didn't understand what was going on. So can you walk me through how your transition was from college to the professional level? Because I know you've been there with some world championships. Mm-hmm. So, you know, how did that work out for you?
Ooh, my transition was tough. It was super, super tough. A large part of it being that, you know, I came out of college and I was one of the best in the nation. I was the best quarter miler coming out that year. I had the accolades. I made the team. I had the records. Like, I did everything you're quote unquote supposed to do on paper. So, you know, I'm expecting to get a deal within like my first month being out, 2 months max. And that just was far from the case. It was like a full 6 months before I signed. Wow. Yeah. So for me, it was like, I'm seeing everyone else sign and I'm like, what is going on? Like, I did everything I'm supposed to do. Like, I don't get it. So it was dealing with that. And then showing up to practice, like, what the heck am I working hard for when I did that for the past 4 years and I have nothing, like, I got nothing out of it. So yeah. Trying to be motivated all during fall training, and that like took a big toll on me mentally. So, you know, when it came time to compete my first year pro, it was like, I finally had the shoe deal, but all that training that I did the months prior and whatnot, I wasn't really fully in it. I wasn't invested. I wasn't hitting times that like I should have been hitting. So it showed when it came to races. I was struggling to hit times I like hit with ease freshman, sophomore year of college. And, you know, like coming meet after meet, you don't have any positive experiences to build up on. It's just progressively getting worse and worse. I know my first year pro, I cried after like every single track meet, every meet. It was just me and my agent, like, I'm crying, I'm trying to figure it out, like, what is happening? And so it was a super tough transition for me, but, you know, ended up making the world team that year. It went better than it did the first time I made the world team. So it wasn't all bad. It was definitely like a learning experience, but for me personally, that transition was very, very tough. And also having to be like, you know, in college, you have a meet every week. So if yeah. things don't go well the meet before, you're like, all right, it's all good. We bounce back. We have another meet next week. We'll get it together. But on the pro circuit, you're only as good as your last race, and you have to earn your way into that race. It's not a guarantee like when you're on a college team. So having to be at your best every single time when you step on that line is was something really tough, especially for me, because I'm the type of runner who I get better with each and every race. So we may start off a little rocky, but you can't do that at the pro level. You've got to be on 10 every single time.
Trust me, I know. I know. I experienced the back end of that. It's like, hey, you can't just show up and thank you God's gift to the track. And yeah, I understand. So one thing that I really, really, I watch a lot of track. I get fired up watching it. I watch men and women all the time, you know. So I noticed something specific about your running style. And I know that everyone loves to ask you the question about that amazing 4x4 run. I know you probably get tired of talking about it, but see, I was familiar with you before the 4x4 run, but I'm gonna get to that. Okay. I have to ask you, because you're the only person that I've seen execute this all the time. And I'm trying to figure out, how does she do this all the time? Like, they know that she's going to do it and she does it all the time. The very first 50 meters of that 400, you always go from the inside and end up taking the inside and winning all the time. I'm like, man, this is amazing, because it's like, you know what's going to happen, you see what's going to happen, and then it happens and nobody stops it, and you do it every time without penalty. That is amazing to me. How do you do that?
Oh, I'm so glad you peeped that. Well, I do it without penalty because I'm not doing nothing wrong. So, well, that's my
answer.
But I don't like to run on the outside. I don't want to. The outside has extra meters. And I feel like if there's enough space for me to get on the inside, then I'm going to take it. You know, like, don't let me in. The other runners, like, there should have never been a space for me to squeeze through, but there always is. So I'm like, hey, who am I to not take this opportunity in front of me? Like, it's here, I'm gonna take it. So, hey, you gotta, I think there's been like one runner who like boxed me out, and I was like, all right, like, she got that, because you should let me on the inside, like, she got that, cool. But yeah, no, it's there, I'm gonna take the opportunity. And I kind of have an idea that regardless of if I'm going inside or out, I'm gonna be in front of you for the rest of the race. So let me just make it easier on myself and just take the inside like while I can.
It's a very interesting strategy, because I watched it several times with several different races. And I'm gonna tell you a specific race that I watched that, I was also a quarter miler too before I decided to retire the spikes and put on sweatpants. So I know the back end of the 400 very well. And so for myself, when I watch you run the back end of the 400, it's very interesting also. But when I watched your indoor race, your senior season.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know which race I'm talking about. Yeah.
I love that race.
It was the same thing, except for you cut in the inside. And you just rode it all the way around. And I thought that was very impressive, because the young lady was right on your heels and you just would not let her pass. And that brings me to the next question that I want to ask you, because I know that there's 400 runners. Like, a lot of people can run the 400, but then there's 400 quarter horses. What do you feel like fuels you to have that type of intensity and that heart to will you through the end of your races? Because I know your legs are feeling the way they are. I know you're tired. What wills you through the end of your races?
A few things. It's partially, I know how talented I am. I know I was blessed with a gift and I ought to use it. So that's always a very big part of it. Like, if you know your potential to do something, you want to do everything you can to reach it. I love and appreciate and respect my coach so much, Coach Quincy Watts. And that's like, I call him my bestie, like that, like I ride for Coach Watts, okay? So he puts so much time and effort into me, curates the workouts to a T, always has open conversations, and he really goes above and beyond what a coach should do. So when I step onto the track, I'm like, I'm going to make him proud. Like, I'm not going to sit here and waste this man's time, because he's putting so much effort into me. So a combination of just not wanting to disappoint myself. Yes, but I can live with that, but I don't want to disappoint him. So I'm going to give 110% every time. And you know, if that works out in my favor, sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't, but hey, the effort's always there. So that's where that comes from.
Trust me, you're very, very, very good at that. So I'm very familiar with you. So whenever I seen you run on the pro level, I've also seen you run at the Mount SAC meet.
Right.
And so I understand completely. You know, I think you have a very unique running style, and you're a tactician. You're not just a runner.
Yeah.
And so it's definitely appreciated here. So Let me get to the good stuff. So, I have one question for you. Are you currently running right now?
No, I just shut down my season like last week and a half ago.
Okay.